wandered in the shadows and found a God who relentlessly pursues. I hid from you, haunted by my failure, and found a God whose grace still covers me. I fell on you when I was at my weakest, and found a God, the lifter of my head. And I've worshipped you and felt you right beside me. You're the reason that I sing, 'cause you're the God of all my days. Each step I take, you make a way, and I will give you all my praise. My seasons change, searching, God, you are my answer. In my blindness, God, you are my vision. In my bondage, God, you are my freedom. In my weakness, God, you are my
you are. it's a new horizon. Oh, I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to. Because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on.
Together, that's what I say to me. I put on the pressure, you could do better, be who you're supposed to be. But that's when you came in, right when I needed you. You said all of the things that I was believing, not one of them were true. You lifted my head up, I was keeping my head down. I didn't know love, but I do now. Cause you stood right there. Not keeping score, not anymore, not since you rescued me. You lifted my head up, I was keeping my head down. I didn't know love, but I do now. Cause you stood right there, and then you broke up.
everybody here looking for revival in our own hearts and across the land. Anybody looking for a revival, lift up your voice and say amen. Lift up your voice and say amen. Anybody here looking for revival in our own hearts and across the land.
Church, please stand this morning and let's sing to our great God. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah. I raise a high.
of the storm.
Thank you so much. You can be seated.
Good morning, Fellowship family. If you're a first-time guest, we are thrilled to have you here. Please fill out a connection card in the back of the seat in front of you and turn it into the black communication boxes in the back or to a volunteer at the Welcome Center. We pray that you'll be blessed by worshiping with us this morning.
If you are new to Fellowship and would like an opportunity to have lunch with Pastor and learn more about the vision, mission, and values of our church, register for our Connecting to Fellowship lunch on Sunday, August 22nd at fellowship301.org or on the Church Center app.
Sefner VBS begins tonight at 6:30, and we are excited about what God is going to do. Grab your kids, friends, and neighbors, and join us as we set sail for Mystery Island. VBS at the 301 campus begins next Sunday, July 25th. There is still time to register your kids at fellowship301.org/VBS or on the Church Center app.
Next week is Baptism Sunday. If you have trusted Christ as your Savior and have never taken the step of following Christ in baptism, sign up at fellowship301.org or on the Church Center app, and a pastor will contact you with more information.
Don't forget to sign up for summer seminars. This Saturday, Pastor David Schmidt and Brett Tripp will be co-leading Becoming a Better Leader. This will be a great opportunity for men and women to learn practical ways to be more intentional in their influence. Also on July 31st, Pastor Mike and Pastor Dave Dahmer will be leading a Send 50 evangelism training where you can learn to share your faith clearly and confidently. Register at fellowship301.org or on the Church Center app.
Mark your calendars for Sunday, August 8th, as we kick off the new school year with a back-to-school blast at our 301 campus. We will have professional fireworks, great food, inflatables, and fun for the whole family. There will also be a school supply drive to serve our communities. Find these details and more at fellowship301.org or on the Church Center app. Looking forward to seeing you there.
Good morning. Man, we are here. It's our midsummer stretch, and it's good for me to be back off of vacation. We had a great time, and so good to be back here with you guys this morning. And hey, just in case you know, you can get the In the Know handout when you come in, and it has all the announcements you just heard and a few more written down, so you could take that with you. A couple of things I wanted to just mention out of the announcements. One of the things on there I'm very, very excited about coming up is probably for over a year and several months now, we have not had any kind of worship choir going on, and we want to get that back online. And so the second Sunday in August, we're going to begin practicing with the choir, regathering it, and the choir will be working together on music for Christmas. And so Christmas is always such an exciting time with music. So if you have any interest in using your voice, honoring the Lord, glorifying God, in being a part of a worship choir, that will begin, as I said, the second Sunday in August. Now, one of the things that people have said, hey, I'd love to be in the choir, but choir practice is Sunday night, and I just can't get back on Sunday night. We got your solution. Choir practice will be on Sunday mornings, not on Sunday night. It'll begin at 9:25 over in the teen worship space, right after the 8:30 worship service that takes place over there. So you can go in there at 8:30. You can either attend, you can go in there at 9:25. You can either attend the 8:30 worship or the 11 o'clock worship, and just be a great time growing the choir, building people together, and preparing for Christmas. So I'll be telling you a little bit more about that, and you'll be hearing more from us about that. But I wanted to go ahead and get you on your radar. That is 3 weeks from now. We mentioned VBS kicking off tonight over at our Sefner campus, and very excited. One thing I wanted to mention to you is over at Sefner this week, and then here next week, I'll be teaching an adult class during VBS called End Time Prophecy in the Book of Daniel. And so that will be this week, Sunday through Tuesday,
at our Sefner campus, and then next week, Sunday through Wednesday. I taught it a couple of years ago, the study, but I feel like it'd be a good time to dig back into their end time prophecy in the book of Daniel. Man, it's so good to see you guys here with us this morning. I'm Pastor Mike, and just want to welcome you. If you're a guest with us, man, we'd just love for you to take that Connect card, drop it in one of the boxes on your way out, or go online, as they told you on the video. And this is our time where we also focus on giving and generosity to the Lord. And so I do want to say to our guests, when we talk about generosity, we have no expectation on our guests to give. We believe that's our responsibility to take care of the church. And so we welcome you. We invite you here today. Members, regular attenders, man, thank you guys so much for your generosity. Even in the middle of summer, it enables us to do things like VBS and the different outreaches that are available. So thank you so much. Would you join me in prayer now as we ask God to continue just meeting with us this morning? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we are so grateful for the goodness that you display and you show to us all the time. God, we ask, Lord, that you would be glorified, Lord, as we continue worshiping you. Prepare our hearts to hear from you and to receive your word today. God, we pray for the kids that are meeting this hour. We pray for adults meeting in life groups. Lord, we just ask you, Lord, to bless, Lord, the works of our hands as we tell others about your son, Jesus Christ, and the importance of a personal relationship with him today. May you be glorified, Lord, in our worship. We pray. We ask all of that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I would invite you to stand again and let's continue in worship. Thank you, God, for even one more day to worship.
Save that thou art. Thou
Bible says in the book of Colossians, He is before all things, and by Him all things consist. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that there's somebody besides me holding all this together, and that's Jesus. Amen. Without with me, it would all fall apart, but with Christ, He holds it all together. Let's all sing together on this first verse of the anthem.
You come at the right time, when I least expect it, never
God for his faithfulness. You guys go ahead and sit down this morning. We're going to be in the Word of God today in Romans chapter number 3. So why don't you go ahead and make your way to Romans chapter number 3. I'm very excited to be back in our study, our summer in Romans. And last couple of weeks, appreciate those who have covered for me. We had Jim Smith, missionary to South Africa. And then Adam Branscombe did a great job 2 weeks ago. Branscombe's spent about 12 years, just come back from China. And then last week, Sean Tice, really in his ministry, of ministering to the fatherless right here in America. So a great midsummer exposure to our mission outreach, engaging our communities and beyond with the life-changing gospel and love of Jesus Christ. And now here we are, we're back in Romans, and it's been our desire. I'll tell you, the book of Romans, it's kind of the mountain peak of the Bible. If you want to understand the scripture, you can start in Paul's letter to the Romans. You can start in verse 1, chapter 1, verse 1, and just study through that book. And by the time you got to the last verse of the 16th chapter, you probably have touched on about every single topic there can possibly be in the Bible. So man, study the Bible out through Romans. What a wonderful, enriching thing to our faith. And so what we're doing, we're studying through the book of Romans. We're going to do it over 3 summers. We don't want to rush it. And so just our summer in Romans. Imagine that you are just scrolling on social media and you see an event coming up that your favorite band is going to be in town. You're pretty psyched about it. You've always wanted to see them in person, haven't had that opportunity. And you look at the date, you pull out your calendar, man, you circle the date, you're psyched about it, you're ready, you're talking to your friends about it, you're letting people know, you can't believe they're going to be here, you're going to see them in person. Man, you kind of already think about, hey, where am I going to go eat before the concert? Because you don't want to eat at the concert because it's too expensive, you go broke, right? So you always go out and eat first, right? And then where am I going to park? How early do I have to leave to deal with the concert traffic? And so all that, you got all mapped out, all planned out. The day comes, man, you get up, it's concert day, you're excited, you're going to be going to the concert, and you leave, you go eat, you go get your parking place, you're at the venue, and you see the crowds coming up out of the parking lot, everyone's energized, excited, man, you get up there to the building, and the lines are there, and you're so excited, people are talking about, man, the favorite song they have, man, someone says, well, I heard them back at such and such, and they did this song, and you're just so excited, and you're just part of the unity of this moment and this day. And you get up to the building and the event staff person comes up to you and he says, can I see your ticket, please? And in that moment, you realized every single thing you did to that moment was absolutely worthless because you didn't get a ticket. You can't get into a concert without a ticket. You know what? It's the same thing with heaven, except it's not a paper ticket we hold in our hand. You see, righteousness is the ticket to heaven. Righteousness, but not just any old righteousness. You see, without righteousness, there's no chance of entrance into heaven. But it's not any old righteousness the Bible speaks about. It's perfect righteousness. This is how Jesus said it in Matthew chapter 5. Jesus said, I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. You understand who the scribes and the Pharisees were? The Pharisees fasted 2 days every week. The Pharisees gave 1/10 of every single thing they possessed, so much so that they would even give 1/10 of the herbs that they would pick out of their gardens. Man, they were so strict, they'd go into their cabinet and take out the pepper shaker and measure out 1/10 and bring it and give it. They were strict students of the word. Man, they were dogmatic adherents to the law of God. And yet Jesus said, even their righteousness, the most humanly righteous people that have ever been known to man. And Jesus said, unless you have a righteousness that's beyond that, you're not entering into heaven. Except your righteousness not measures it, it exceeds it. He said, you will in no case, in no wise, in no circumstance will you enter into heaven without a righteousness that exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees. So what he's saying, there's no righteousness you can get in this earth that's ever going to get you into heaven. You have to have a righteousness that comes from God. See, what you need for an entrance into heaven is you need the righteousness of God. And that's what Paul is talking to us about here in Romans chapter 3 and beginning in verse 21. As a matter of fact, in these few verses that we look at this morning, he's going to talk about the righteousness of God four different times. Look with me, verse 21. He said, but now, the righteousness of God. Without the law is manifest, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even, second time, the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there's no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation. Don't be afraid of that big Bible word. We'll get back to that in a minute. Through faith in his blood to declare his what? His, there it is again, to declare his, God's righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believes in Jesus. Four times in the passage we're looking at today, Paul mentions the righteousness of God, his righteousness. Jesus said, without that righteousness, you will not be able to enter into the kingdom of heaven. So here's what I would say to you, is righteousness is a pretty big deal, huh? It's an important thing, and so if it's such an important thing, and by the way, it's given to us as a gift, but the righteousness of God is such an important thing, we got to ask one question right now. What's the question? What is righteousness? What is righteousness? Well, the word righteousness and the word righteous appear 540 times in the Bible. By the way, on the other hand, the words faith, faithfulness, and faithful are only found 348 times in the scripture. Here's what that means. The word righteous is found 1.5 times more in the scriptures than even faith. The Bible talks about more about righteousness than faith, and that's not insignificant when you understand this. The Bible says without faith, it's what? It's impossible to please God. The Bible says without faith, we can't please God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Four times in Scripture, the Bible says this phrase. It says, the just shall live by faith. Yet righteousness, as important as faith is, and none of us would doubt the importance of faith, you can't please God without it. Yet righteousness is mentioned 1.5 times more in the Scripture than faith is mentioned. So what does righteous mean? Well, there's a lot of uses of righteous. Some of them aren't even biblical uses. They're just kind of in life uses. For example, the Jews have a custom. Any non-Jewish people who aided and assisted the Jews against the Nazis during the Holocaust, they enter them into a hall of the righteous nations. Means the righteous ones who assisted us. And that's not a biblical use, but that's a use of the word righteous. Hey, a righteous person back in the 80s was a really cool person. A righteous dude, right? And that was in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, right? So righteous can be used for a lot of things. It can be thrown around. If you look it up in a dictionary, probably have a definition. But what does the Bible mean when it says righteousness? Well, a simple definition is this. It's simply a right standing with God. Righteousness is the condition of being in a right relationship with God. So what does it mean to be righteous? It means I am in a right relationship with God. The condition of my heart is in a right relationship with God. And by the way, that right relationship is not defined by us. It is defined by God himself. Historical background. If you go to the Old Testament customs and cultures, we see its uses in the Bible in this way, the word for righteousness. Let's say a man or a woman goes to the market and they go up to the guy who's selling grain and they say, hey, I want X amount of grain. And the guy whips out his scales and it's got the beam and it's got the, you know, the two plates on either side. I used to use those scales back in my day before Christ for other things. But anyway, you pull those scales out and And on one side, he takes out a weight of the measure of what you want. And he places that weight. I can see who got that, Phil. All right. And he places his weight, and his wife's going, don't encourage him. Places the weight on the scale on this side. And then he starts putting the grain on the other side. And as the grain gets on this side, the weight starts rising. And what? He does it until it is balanced. You know the word there? That's considered a righteous weight. That's what it tells us in Proverbs 16:11. It says a just or a righteous weight and balance is the Lord's. Now, the teaching principle of that is we should have honesty in our life. We should have integrity. Man, the weights that we bring to the table in our business practices ought to be fair. They ought to be honest. They ought to be righteous. They ought to measure up against the measurement of what God sees as the right thing. So what Paul is teaching us here is that the perfect standard by which God measures our lives is his absolute holiness. The requirement to be right in the sight of God and acceptable in his sight is that we stand, now get this, in perfect conformity to the moral holiness of God. Now, if that doesn't make you feel insignificant and totally lacking, nothing will. Imagine standing before God on the day of judgment and the imaginary balance, the scale of justice is brought out. And on one side is the perfect, righteous holiness of God. And then you, me, our life is placed on the other side of that scale. Insignificant? Unworthy? You got it. It's like the two cows out in the field, and the milk truck comes by. And on the side of the truck, it said, homogenized, pasteurized, vitamin D, fortified. And the one cow says to the other cow, makes you feel pretty insignificant, doesn't it? That's in the day of God's judgment. That's why in Daniel chapter 5, when God pronounces judgment on the king in verse 27 with the writing on the wall, what did he say? You are weighed in the balances and you're found lacking. You're found wanting. You're found lacking. You're weighed in the balances. You have come short of my standard. What is the standard? Perfect righteousness. Jesus said, except your righteousness rises above the righteousness of the most humanly righteous people you could ever name. He said, you will not enter into the kingdom of God. So the seriousness of the text, what is righteousness? It's living in conformity to the perfect standard. It's weighed in the perfect conformity to God's holiness. Well, who in the world could ever measure up to that? Well, no one could, because the thing we've been studying all along at this point in the book of Romans so far is the deficit of human righteousness. Up to this point in the book of Romans, we've seen the picture of man's condition and his hopelessness. He began the book by talking about God's good news for mankind, and immediately he left the good news in chapter 1. He's talking about the Gentile, the non-Jewish nations, and he said how they are without excuse. Because all the invisible things of God have been revealed to them. They're without excuse. Chapter 2, he moved on to the moral person, the religious person. And he said to them, you're even without excuse. And then he goes on, and we looked at last week, and he kind of summarized it. And he's got the moralist, and he's got the Jew, and he's got the non-Jew. The Jew saw himself there. They're God's chosen people. Of course, they are acceptable to God in their Judaism. But God summarizes it all up in the earlier part of this chapter, in chapter 3 and verse 10. He said, there is None righteous. No, not one. So, Pastor Mike, you're speaking out both sides of your mouth. Either you are or the Bible is, one or the other. I knew that Bible's full of contradictions. Jesus said, unless our righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, we can't enter into heaven. And then you turn around over here and you say, there is none righteous, none at one. Are you saying none of us can go to heaven? Absolutely, I'm saying none of us can go to heaven the way we are. Apart from something intervening into our life. The last section of Romans chapter 3, and beginning in chapter 1 through chapter 3 in verse 19 and verse 20, he was just showing us that all have sinned, all have come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, there is no, not one. He has painted a picture for us. Paul has built a case like a skilled lawyer, line upon line, precept upon precept, showing us that we're hopeless. We're lost. We are without hope of God. There is none of us righteous. No, not one. And how does he end that section? Look at verse 19. He says this. Why did he paint this picture? He said this. That every mouth may be stopped. And all the world may become guilty before God. So what was his point up to this point in the letter to the Romans? It's to get us to stop. Stop talking. Stop justifying. Stop saying, well, my baptism will get me there. Stop saying, man, I've had a great upbringing in my family. That'll get me there. Pastor Mike, I'm here every time the doors are open. That will get me there. He says, stop. Haven't you read what I just said? Every mouth is stopped. Why? Because all the world is become guilty before God. Every man, every woman, every child, white skin, black skin, brown skin, we all have sinned and we all have come short of the glory of God. Every mouth is stopped. But I love what Adam said when he was preaching 2 weeks ago when he got to that point. He said, God stops our mouth so that we'll begin to listen. If you're talking, you're not listening, right? So if I'm so busy justifying myself and I'm so busy convincing God that I'm good and so busy convincing God that I'm a good person and I deserve to go to heaven because of everything I've done, he says, stop. Stop talking. Be still. Shh. Shh. Listen. Listen. And it's in that moment where every mouth is stopped and self-justification has ended, when we come, as it were, to the end of ourselves. In verse 21, he says this, but now, now when? Now with our mouths stopped. Now where we realize there's no other remedy. He says, but now, verse 21, the righteousness of God without the law is manifest. See, mankind is sinful. We are without righteousness. We are without any hope of heaven. But now, God's righteousness for man is revealed. It's made available. You see, God didn't bring you to the place of closing your mouth so he can button it up just to throw you into hell without any hope. He brought you to the end of yourself so he could reveal to you what you need in order to know him and in order to end up in heaven. See, what we need in order to enter heaven one day is to stand complete in a righteousness that can only come from God, can only come from him. It's not in ourselves. We just don't have it. But the righteousness of God is revealed. It is manifest. It is made known to us in this passage. Look at the righteousness of God with me. God's righteousness to us, first of all, God's righteousness is not by our works. It's not by our own works. Look at verse 21. It says, the righteousness of God is revealed. Look what it says. Without the law. It's manifest without the law. Look at verse 28, down a little bit. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. What do you mean, the deeds of the law? I mean works. Chapter 4, he begins talking about Abraham, and he uses the word works versus the word law, because he shows you it's not just the error of law, but even before the law, when Abraham lived, your works wouldn't do it for you. So whether it was the works of people before Moses gave the law, whether it was the works of people during the law Moses gave, whether it's the works of people since the cross of Jesus Christ, he said the righteousness of God is manifest to us without the law. It's not by our own works. Titus said it this way, Titus 3:5. It says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his what? His mercy, he saved us. God says, I don't save you because of your works. God says, I save you because of my mercy. Well, what is the mercy of God? The mercy of God is God not giving us what we deserve. Well, what do I deserve? Well, we deserve to be separated from God. We deserve to be out of relationship with him. We deserve not to know eternal life. Why? Because our righteousness doesn't measure up. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Titus says, God doesn't save us because of our works. It's not by your works. He says the righteousness of God in Romans 3 is manifest without the law. You see, the problem with trying to get to heaven by works is the standard's too high. There's no way. The mountain is too high. You just would never be able to obtain it. Imagine if I told you today you want to go to heaven, you have to live perfectly. You'd say, it's too late. I already failed. Exactly. You already failed. If I told you the standard is perfect works, the standard is, man, perfect excellence. But he says, no, the righteousness of God is given to us apart from works. The standard, it would be too high. A couple years ago, we had a couple visiting the church, and they started coming, and the man was a believer and his wife wasn't. And she was part of a religion that taught you how to work your way to heaven. You had to earn your way to heaven. I went over to their house, and I was speaking with her, and she was sharing with me the religion she was a part of and how it works and, you know, what you had to do in order to go to heaven, and laid it all out for me. And I'm listening to her, and she grew up in this, devoted. Her dad baptized her into this religion. It was in her heart. I think that moment, the Lord just gave me a question to ask her. And I said to her, I said, can I ask you a question? She said, yeah. I said, how do you know when you've done enough? And I'm telling you, it was like letting the air out of a balloon. Her countenance fell, her shoulders shrugged, her head went down. And she said to me, and you could tell it was a pain she'd been carrying. She said, that's the problem. I just don't know when I've ever done enough. See, it's not. Now, I'm happy to tell you that woman got saved a couple of weeks later. I'll even tell you who she is. She's Bart Denny's wife, Jennifer, and Bart's one of the pastors in our church now. Miraculous change, transformation. But you know what brought it about? She quit trying, and she started trusting. Because the righteousness of God, although available to us, does not come by our own works. Here's the second thing we see in this passage. The righteousness of God to us, it only comes to us by faith. It's only by faith. Look at verse 22. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that what? Believe. The faithfulness of Jesus Christ in going to the cross and dying for our sins has allowed us to be able to receive the righteousness of God by faith, not by our own works. That's why back in chapter 1 in verse 17, remember Paul said this? He said, the just shall live by faith. And by the way, when you see the word just in the Bible, it's really a synonym for righteousness. Just means someone who is just is one who has been made or declared righteous by God. So they're very similar. So you could say it this way: the righteous shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. Hey, in the passage we're looking at and studying right now, faith is a key component. It talks about faith here in verse 22. Talks about faith in 25, talks about faith in verse 26, talks about faith in verse 28, talks about faith in verse 30. I mean, it's just saturated with faith. Why? Because faith is how we receive God's righteousness. That's why it's so important that we are continually, as individuals and as a church, we're speaking the gospel, the good message, the word of God to other people. Why? Because without the gospel, there's no faith. See, the message that Jesus died and he was buried and that he rose again, that's what creates faith in us. It's we hear that message and the Holy Spirit applies it to our hearts. That's where faith, we don't conjure up faith. I don't work up faith. I don't try hard. I try hard enough, I'll get faith. I'll get faith. I'm working. What are you doing? Working for faith. No, that's not how faith comes. Romans 10, 17 says this: faith comes by what? Hearing. Hearing what? Hearing the word of God. So the whole point of this entire letter to the Romans by Paul, it's the good news of God for the world. It's the gospel. Well, why is the gospel important? Because it is the only way you can be made righteous. It's the only way that you can have entrance into God's eternal kingdom. And as you sit there today listening to the word of God being preached to you, you know, as you're listening, you know what's happening in you? God's developing faith in you. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ this morning, God's given you faith. He's given you faith to live for him. He's given you faith to trust him. He's given you faith for the difficulties of life. He's giving you faith to believe his word. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, faith comes by hearing. He's building you up in your faith, Jude said. But you know, maybe you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Maybe you've never rested in Christ as Lord and Savior. Maybe you've never actually known Jesus Christ in that personal way. Well, I will tell you something. Faith in Jesus Christ comes through the message that you are hearing this morning. And it's by the hearing of the word that faith is produced in you today. Faith is not something we have to work up. Faith is something that God develops in us through his word. That's why as a church, it's so important that we are continually preaching it. And you're here this morning and you're hearing God's word. And if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, today is the day where God can create that faith in you that will help you, will allow you to receive the gift of his righteousness. So God's righteousness to us is not by our own works. It only comes by faith. Hey, by the way, it's available to all who believe. It's not exclusive. It says in verse 22 and 3, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ. And look at this. Who's the faith, the righteousness to? It says, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. For what? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You see, there's not a person on the face of this earth that's ready to face God in their own goodness. But all that believe are candidates for his righteousness. I love that children's song that when I first became a Christian, I started working in a children's church, and this is one of the songs we taught the kids. Jesus loves the little children. All the children of the world, red, brown, yellow, black, and white, they're all precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. You say, why is that? The need is universal. Therefore, the remedy must be as well. Man, it doesn't matter. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. Man, God created people in black and in brown and in bronze and in white and all of these shades. And in those shades, he created them in the Imago Dei, the image of God. That black man you see is black in the image of God. That brown-skinned person is brown-skinned in the image of God. That Caucasian person is that in the image of God. And we have made something of that, that God, we have human construct that God had nothing to do with. We somehow attached value to it. We attached priority to it. We detached discrimination to it. And we did all of these things. And God was like, man, I was just giving the world variety. Man, I was just painting a palette that's beautiful. Black person is beautiful in their blackness. Brown-skinned person is beautiful in the color of their skin. Caucasian people really should be the colored people. If it gets cold, we change one color. It gets warm, we turn another color. We get mad, we're another color. It just doesn't make any sense. You understand? That's the image of God. Hey, we have opinions, we have prejudices, we have distinctions we make, but I want to tell you something. You better check them at the door of the cross because the ground's level. There's no place for that at the cross. Why? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all in the same boat. We're all in the same need. Therefore, he said, the righteousness of God is to all and upon all. Because there is, God says there's no difference. God says there's no difference. You say, I don't like that verse. Well, get over it, because that's what God said. There is no difference. For the same Lord, it says in Romans 10, is rich unto all who call upon him. We all have sinned. We all come short of the glory, the majesty, short of the righteousness of God. That's why missions is so important in our church, global outreach. That's why the last few weeks we had a guy speaking who's from South Africa, another guy speaking who spent a decade over in China, and then talking about, you know, the fatherless of America. Tonight we begin a vacation Bible school in Sefner. We have another one over here. Why is that? Because we're engaging our communities. Sefner here and beyond, America, China, South Africa. Why are we doing that? Because God's righteousness is available to all who believe. He doesn't discriminate it, and neither should we. Some people say, well, I think giving money overseas, it's like throwing money down a rat hole. No, it's not. It's investing in the mission and the message of Jesus Christ so that God's righteousness can be made available to everyone who will believe that message. Here's another thing. God's righteousness, it's given as a free gift. Look at verse 24. It says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. When you see the word justified, it means made righteous. Means declared righteous. Well, how are we declared righteous by God? How do we get that righteousness we need? He says we get it freely. You don't buy it? You don't do anything to get it? Don't I have to come to church every Sunday to get it? No, you have to come to church every Sunday to make your pastor happy, not to get into heaven. He said we are made righteous, how? Freely, by the grace that comes through Jesus Christ. We are made righteous. It is given to us as the gift of God. Look at Ephesians 2, 8, 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. Look at it. It's the gift of God. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. How am I saved? By grace. How am I saved? Not by myself. How am I saved? Not of works. How am I saved? It's the gift of God. You need to be righteous to get into heaven, and you're not. But God will make you righteous, and he'll do it as a gift to you. And by the way, God prohibits strongly any works being added to grace. You add works to grace, guess what? It's not grace any longer. Look at Romans chapter 11 and verse 6. He said, if it's by grace, then it's no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it's of works, then it's no more of grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. What's he saying? He said, if it's grace, it can't be of works. Because it's of works, it can't be grace. And if it's of works, then it can't be grace. Otherwise, work, what's he saying? Words build worlds. Words have meanings. Grace means one thing. Works mean another thing. You can't say it's by grace and then say it's by works. A religious leader in the same religion, the lady came out of, I was telling you about, visited our church one Sunday night. One of their elders had a name tag on, a white shirt. About seven of them came to one of our services. Want to know what was going on over here. Their people were getting saved. So I was talking about grace. I said, well, how do you explain grace in your religion? He said, oh, it's easy. He said, you do everything you can and you get as far as you can go. And the part you can't get, then God will give you that part by grace. I said, that's a good answer. There's only one problem with it. He said, what's that? I said, it's not in the Bible. What's the Bible say? If it's grace, it can't be of works. And if it's of works, it can't be of grace. So we have a righteousness we don't have that we need, and God wants to give it to us. You can't buy for it. You can't earn it. You can't deserve it. You can only receive it. See, grace and works cannot coexist. It's either grace or it's works, but it can't be both. And God tells us that it is grace. You say, well, if it's free, then how does that mean it's universal, that every single person automatically gets it? No. It has to be received by faith. Well, faith in what? Faith in Jesus. Look at this. The gift, what he did for us there, the righteous God is made available to us by what Jesus did on the cross. God's righteousness has been provided by Jesus Christ. Grace, righteousness is a free gift. It's not cheap. It's not invaluable. It's costly. It's precious. It's valuable. Look what he says in verse 24. Being justified freely by his grace. How? Look. Through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. What does redemption mean? It means he paid a price for our sin. He paid a price for my transgression. He redeemed me from the curse of the law by being made a curse for me on the cross. Do you realize on the cross, Jesus literally became a curse in my place? And he took my curse and he took your curse and he took the penalty of our sin. And in verse 25, it says, God has set him forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. Where was Jesus' blood poured out for us? On the cross. Now, that word propitiation, don't be scared. Don't be us scared. Propitiation, yes, I just did say that. Propitiation, it means to appease or to satisfy. It simply means that what Jesus did on the cross satisfied God's anger against our sin. I've used the illustration before, guys. You get in a blowout with your wife in the morning at the house, and you're arguing, and she's mad, and you're mad, and you storm out the door to work. And there's only one problem. You get in the car and you start driving, you realize, man, this is my fault. Isn't it horrible? You're in there, you're fighting with your wife, you're arguing. We don't fight, right, Cheryl? We don't fight. We discuss. You're having an intense discussion with your spouse. And you're like, and you're waxing eloquent, guys. And you go, yeah, point one, point two, point three, point four, yeah, there. And she walks away and you walk away and instantly you realize you're so full of it. You are absolutely wrong. You go to work, man, and you're stewing over it all day. You're like, oh, man, I was wrong. Oh, man, I'm going to go home. She's going to get all over me and I'm going to have to listen and nod my head because I know she's right. And then you get a great idea. You know, I'm going to appease her anger toward me before I get there. So on the way home, what do? You stop at the florist. You get the flowers and you come home and you go and you say, hey, hon, love you. I was so wrong today, honey. I'm just wrong. There's just no excuse. I love you. I treasure you. I value you. You know what you've just done? You have propitiated your wife. You've appeased her anger through sacrifice, through a gift. Jesus appeased the wrath of God toward us when he died on the cross for our sins. John Piper said this, God saw his glory being despised by mankind. And rather than vindicating the worth of his glory by slaying his people, he vindicated his glory by slaying his son. God in heaven saw his glory being despised by us, being rejected by us, being pushed aside by us. And rather than vindicating his glory by pouring his wrath on us, he poured it out on his son. He slayed his son. See, the gift of righteousness has been paid for by Jesus Christ on the cross. And finally coming full circle back to God, the Father can justly make us just because of the cross. The Father can justly make us just because of the cross. Look down at verse 26, the last verse in our section. On the cross, it says, God sent Jesus there. He said, to declare, I say, at this time, at what time? At the time when all the mouths are stopped, all the world is guilty before God. To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that God might be just and the justifier of him which believes in Jesus. Now get this. God says one of the reasons he sent Jesus to the cross is so by dying, he was declaring God's righteousness. He was putting his righteousness on display. He was showing us that sin is not a light thing. It's not an easy thing. It requires a death. It requires a sacrifice. And God, paying for sin at the expense of his own son, was God declaring his perfection, declaring his righteousness. And it says he did it that he might be just. You say, well, God is already just. Yes, he is. But if he had forgiven sin without the debt being paid, he would have never been just any longer. God was just. And the justifier, God is righteous and able to make us righteous justly because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. I want to tell you something this morning. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, if you think God saved you and forgave you because you're a good person, if you think God went up and said, oh, John, he's a good guy. Man, John's awesome. He's got an awesome wife, man. He's got some good kids. John's the man. God said, you know, John, God comes over and says, John, you know what? I'm just going to overlook it. You're a good dude. And he punched you on the shoulder. If you think that's what God's mind was when he forgave your sin, you don't understand righteousness. Let me tell you something. God has never overlooked a sin, ever. Never. God did not overlook your sins. God does not overlook sin. Why? Because then he would not be just in justifying us. He would be unjust. He would cease to be righteous. There would be no righteousness for us. But through the perfect plan of God, when his son was made a sacrifice for sin in his perfection on the cross, the Father was enabled, as it were, to forgive your sin and to forgive my sin. Grace is free, but it's not cheap. It's costly. And that's really the whole heart of what the gospel is all about. It's really this, these three things. Number one, God is righteous. Jeanette, there you go. All right. God is righteous. God demands righteousness from us, and God provides us with righteousness. You see, why the gospel? Why did Jesus have to die? Why the good news? Why do we proclaim Christ? Because God's righteous. And a righteous God must demand righteousness or he ceases to be righteous. But a gracious God righteously provides that righteousness for us. through the death of his son. It's going back to that concert. No ticket, can't get into a concert without a ticket. Bummed, you turn away, but in that moment, as you turn, there's a man standing that says, hey, wait. He overheard the conversation. He says, come with me. It's the promoter of the concert. He's the one that rented the hall. He's the one that's actually selling the tickets. It's his group that is there. And he says, man, I seen how excited you were about getting in here. I saw your love for the group. You come with me. You don't need a ticket when you come with me because I own it all. That is what God did. He did for us what we could not do for ourselves. But the gift must be received by faith, by faith, by hearing, by receiving today. Would you all bow your heads with me this morning as we close our time of the word and worship this morning? Let me just say this. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ right now, man, and you have been discounting the worth and the value of Jesus. We sang a song at 8:30 this morning, and it said, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. And we love the Jesus paid it all teaching of the Bible, don't we? Jesus paid it all. Woo, I love that. He paid it all. I don't have to do anything. But then the other side of that equation is all to him I owe. Oh, we stumble on that. We trip on that. Everything I owe, all that I am, my intelligence belongs to him. My strength belongs to him. My passions belong to him. My possession, my worth belongs to him. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. That's a correct equation. Believers in Jesus Christ, would you see what Christ did for you? He gave you a gift of righteousness that without you could have never entered into heaven. It's what all about. Righteousness is the ticket to heaven. You cannot go to heaven without his righteousness. You can't. Thank him for it. Maybe this morning you're here and you say, well, I've never received Jesus as my Lord, as my Savior. I don't know that I have that forgiveness that Jesus gives, that righteousness imputed to me, given to me. Well, you know what? About receiving that gift today? How about in your own heart, in the best way you know? How about just calling out to the Lord something like this? Lord, God, I know that I'm undeserving. My mouth sure is stopped, Lord. I understand that there's nothing in me that's going to get me into heaven, God. I understand that, Lord. But I believe that the death Jesus died for me, paid my price, and he proved it by the resurrection. Lord, I believe that. God, would you give me the gift of righteousness today? Jesus, would you become my Savior today? Just calling upon him, Lord, make me yours. Forgive me. Our Lord, we come to you this morning and we thank you for the opportunity we've had to worship, to gather, to hear from your word, for our faith to be increased. Lord, to marvel in the wonders of your infallible, inerrant word, the glories of Jesus Christ on the cross. Lord, I pray that you would, as believers, forgive us where we fail you and where we undervalue the sacrifice Jesus made. God, there should be no place for that in our hearts, our lives, our church, anything. But I pray for those here today that may not know Christ, Lord. I pray their hearts have been truly open to receive him today. As a final thing before we leave today, we say, Pastor, with our heads bowed, our eyes closed, hey, I did pray to God today. I asked him to help me to receive his righteousness, to receive Jesus Christ, to accept that gift by faith today. Would you pray for me? And I want to be able to be praying for you. If there's anyone here at all today, but today you reached out to the Lord by faith. You called upon him. Put your hand just where I could see it. God bless you. Amen. Glad to know that, both of you. Glad to know that. Maybe there's someone else. You say, yeah. God bless you. I see you. God bless these ladies, these needs. Father, may we be able as a church to help them on their journey of faith and following Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. For his sake. Amen. Hey, thank you guys so much, man. You guys are so attentive and value the Word of God so highly. And I thank you so much for that. So excited to be back from vacation and speaking God's Word to you. I just want to remind, if you're a guest today, I'm going to be down in the Connection Center. If I haven't met you already, why don't you come by? I'd love to just meet you in person and buy you a cup of coffee at the cafe. We have great coffee. And let me just say this. If you made a spiritual decision today to follow Christ, or maybe a step in your life, and you'd like some support, some help with that, maybe you need a Bible, maybe you need some follow-up, when you go down the Connection Center, there's a counter down there. It says Next Steps, and those people are there to help you on your journey of faith, okay? Hey, guys, God bless you for coming today. Remember, pray for VB.